Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this learning objective, we are going to focus on muscle compartments, sometimes referred to as fascial compartments. So our goals here are to understand what makes up a muscle compartment, so it's more than just muscle, and then spend a bit of time considering the role fascia plays in musculoskeletal anatomy. A muscle or fascial compartment is composed of a few things. First, it's composed of a group of muscles that are enveloped in deep fascia. So just kind of looking at a group of muscles here that is surrounded by or enveloped within deep fascia. And specifically, so recall that fascia is a generic term for grossly visible connective tissue. And specifically, deep fascia is located deep to the superficial fascia, so this kind of adipose-filled layer or subcutaneous layer under the skin. These muscle compartments that are surrounded by this deep fascia contain groupings of muscles that share a similar neurovascular supply, as well as share similar actions. And in certain areas, there are going to be particularly thick portions of deep fascia, and these are referred to as intermuscular septa. So these are deep fascia as well. They're just thicker portions of the deep fascia that serve to truly compartmentalize, as well as occasionally serve as a muscle attachment site. You don't really see intermuscular septa, or at least prominent ones, other than in the limbs. So it's really where you have these considerable areas of thickening when we're talking about the appendages. Muscle compartments serve several functions, which we will discuss, but I want to note it's also helpful for students of anatomy as it really helps to reduce the cognitive load that comes with learning of all these muscles and all these bones and all these actions and all these nerves. So instead of learning the nerve supply and actions for each individual muscle, instead you can learn that for a grouping of muscles. So you can learn the nerves that supply these four muscles within this muscle compartment and the similar action that occurs with these muscles. So a bit more about deep fascia. As I mentioned, this is grossly visible connective tissue, but importantly in this area, it tends to be continuous with a few things, deeper connective tissue coverings of the muscle, such as that paramecium and the epimecium, in addition to being connected to periosteum that surrounds the bone. The deep fascia that surrounds the compartments, so you'd have deep fascia surrounding the compartments of the muscle, will also limit the outward expansion of the bellies of the contracting muscles. So they're unyielding to a certain extent, the deep fascia. And this helps with the directionality of the venous flow as blood is pushed or directed as the veins of the muscles and the compartments are compressed when there's contraction. So it won't allow for the contraction to spread too far out. It will keep it within the compartment, which will compress appropriately the veins. And so these valves within the veins allow the blood to flow in the correct direction, so towards the heart, and prevent backflow. So the deep fascia, the contracting muscles, and those veins with valves work together as a type of musculovenous pump to return deoxygenated blood to the heart. And this is particularly important in the lower limbs, where blood is moving against the gravitational pull. So there are a lot of functional benefits to these compartments, but there can be issues that arise because the fascial boundaries that limit the compartments are largely inelastic, so not much give there, which, as we mentioned, can be a good thing in helping direct venous blood flow, but in conditions that lead to an increase in the volume of those compartmental contents, such as muscles swelling, local infection, or hemorrhages, that can lead to a significant increase in intercompartmental pressure. And if this pressure, If this increased pressure is not relieved, this can lead to compressive occlusion of vasculature within the compartment, as well as potential damage to the nerves and muscles due to that decreased blood flow to those regions. And this is referred to as compartment syndrome. This can occur in any muscle or fascial compartment, but it is most common in the anterior compartment of the leg. So this region right here. All right, excellent. We have reached the summary slide, and this is our introduction to the muscle or fascial compartments. And we will start in the next learning objective, starting to actually name these muscle compartments and locate these muscle compartments. Thank you for your time and attention here, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.